Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Haifa Kathrin Al-Ali. I am a hemato-oncologist working at the University Hospital of Halle in Germany. I would like to share some of the information which were presented at this EHA about the JAMP trial, where we tried to look closely to the impact of bone marrow fibrosis on response to ruxolitinib. And as you are all well aware, in the JAMP trial, which is the very large trial, which included more than 2,000 patients, the impact of the IPSS, irrespective of the bone marrow fibrosis, was evaluated where patients with intermediate 1 IPSS had a response that was even sometimes better than that, what we know from the COMFORT trials or from patients generally within the JAMP trial with intermediate 2 and high risk. But also, and this is, I think, very important, the degree of anemia was clearly less than if patients were in more advanced phases. But interestingly, in this analysis, we looked at more than 1,000 patients where bone marrow biopsy results were available. And indeed, you know, we have those so-called pre-fibrotic myelofibrosis or patients with myelofibrosis with only minimal degrees of fibrosis. And so we took these patients together, those without fibrosis and those with grade 2 and 3 fibrosis who were termed as high-grade fibrosis patients, and tried to look at these two groups and what the impact of treatment with ruxolitinib would make in the two different groups. I think there are some few messages that this poster brings. First, that symptoms and spleen size, spleen length is actually independent of the degree of fibrosis, meaning that both groups, those with early grade fibrosis and those with advanced fibrosis, both had similar symptomatology and spleen length. This is number one. Number two, it is quite interesting because the notion we usually have is that a patient with low-grade fibrosis usually belongs to an intermediate 1 or early myelofibrosis according to the IPSS. But what is very clear is that when you look at the patient characteristics, this is not the case. And actually, 1/3 of patients with low-grade fibrosis actually belonged to the intermediate 2 or high group high-risk patients according to the IPSS and vice versa. So the degree of fibrosis is not automatically correlating with the IPSS risk group. Third, response to ruxolitinib was good in both groups irrespective of the degree of fibrosis, yet patients with low-grade fibrosis tended to have more responses compared to patients with more advanced fibrosis. And I think this is no surprise. The higher the fibrosis grade, the less likely the number of patients who will profit from treatment with ruxolitinib. Next point is that interestingly, and irrespective of the degree of fibrosis, the time interval between the diagnosis and the start of ruxolitinib seems to be very relevant in terms of response. So that treatment initiated prior to 2 years prior to 2 years from diagnosis tends to be associated with much more response in both the early and the high-grade or advanced fibrosis groups of patients. And another issue is outcome. You know, the median follow-up of these patients and the probability of survival was counted for 144 weeks, which corresponds to 2.7 years. And indeed, again, progression-free survival and survival tend to be better in the lower group fibrosis patients compared to those with more advanced fibrosis in the bone marrow if treated with ruxolitinib. And I think it is, again, no surprise. So the bottom line, the degree of fibrosis, which is known to be a negative prognostic impact on survival by itself, is also influencing the response and probably the outcome, the long-term outcome in terms of progression-free survival and overall survival in patients with myelofibrosis when treated with ruxolitinib. And with this, I would like to